Hey everyone, and welcome to another episode. I'm Ombarus, and this week I'm talking about localization and translation. And to be honest, I was kind of hesitating to make this video because I'm still on the fence for my game Solar Rogue about whether or not I should implement all of the translation stuff, because it's a really big job and I don't know it's really useful before even releasing the first version. But since I wanted to make sure it was possible, I still ended up checking it out and doing a big part of it. So I thought, why not do an introduction video about how to do translation using Godot engine? In case you didn't know, I'm a French-Canadian, so my first language is French, and I'm making YouTube video in English, and right now I'm living in Japan and speaking in Japanese. So I kind of have a good idea of how important localization and translation is for video game development. If you think that translating a video game is as simple as, I don't know, getting your Spanish friend to change the words in your game, I've got some news for you. It's quite a bit more complicated than that. Hopefully, Godot has some really nice tools to help you at least get started. Looking at the documentation for Godot, you can see that there's kind of two methods of doing localization. One is a simple, convenient, easy way using CSV files, that's comma-separated files. And the other one uses the getText implementation that's common in Unix system. And it's a little bit more powerful, it has more features, but it's also more complicated to use. And that's why for my project Solar Rogue, I decided to go with the simple CSV file format. But if you have experience using getText, I'd really like to know your experience and how it compares to other localization, because I think I've used it in the past long time ago, but I don't really remember and I didn't want to get back into it for my project. So that's why I just decided to go with CSV and I haven't looked much into the getText implementation. The first step is pretty easy. You just need to create your CSV file. And this CSV file just needs the header row that has the ID column and then a column for each language you want to implement. And the header for each of these columns needs to be the standard language identifier that you can find pretty much everywhere on the internet. For example, English is EN, French is FR, and Japanese is JA. And then you just need to drop it in your data folder, and Godot will just automatically assume that any .csv file is a translation file and will attempt to compile each language from the CSV into their own separate output result. And just a side note here, you have to be extra careful when you're doing the header for your CSV file, because at first, for example, I was putting spaces between each of the language identifier, and this just failed by giving me a random error saying that the language EN didn't exist. And it took me a while to notice that it was actually the language space EN. And I don't know why they are not trimming the spaces at the beginning and the end, but you have to be careful. It seems like the interpreter for the CSV file is really sensitive about this. Once your CSV file is successfully imported in Godot, you just go into your project setting, you go into the localization tab, and then you add the compiled localization file for each language. And you have to be careful because my first impression was that I needed to add the actual CSV file, but that's not gonna work and it's not gonna throw any error, it's not gonna give you any warning, your translations are just not going to work, and it's kind of hard to figure out why. And it took me a while, but I figured that it's important that you add the compiled translation that ends in like ja.translation or something. And honestly, I don't quite understand this system, because if Godot generated those files, why does it need me to tell him that these files exist? But whatever, that's how it is and you need to do it like that. But once it's done, then your translation should start working, because Godot will automatically use the text of your buttons and label to try to translate into the language. And if you want to change the language for testing purpose, you can still, again, in your project setting, go into the local settings, and then you can define a test language so you can switch between language while you're testing. And if you look, you can see that the buttons and the label will change automatically based on your translation in the CSV file. And personally, I like to make the key the English translation so that if I'm missing some translation, at least I don't see something like text:01 or something like that as an ID, but I see the actual English. At the very least, I feel that if there's a missing translation, maybe like a French speaker will be able to read the English. But if it's just a random ID like text:005 then you're fucked. So personally, I prefer to use the English as a key, but there's a caveat to that, because if your text has multiple line, the CSV file can handle characters like backslash n for a new line, but if it's in the ID, then it's not gonna work. So if you have a line that has multiple line, that's kind of weird to say, but if you have a line with multiple line, then you'll have to make sure that this line is a special ID in the ID column, and then you can have your translation with multiple lines and backslash n and stuff like that inside your translation file. Then, of course, there's like text that might be dynamic that you set in JavaScript. And there's also, in my case, I'm using a lot of rich text label to add colors and bold and italics to my text. And these are not translated automatically. The text in them will not be automatically used as an ID to translate in the translation table. But it's pretty easy to set up. All you need to do is actually go into your JavaScript, and there's a handy method tr that you can put in front of all your strings that you want to display, and it will try to fetch this ID in the translation table and return the actual string translated. So now that the basic setup is out of the way, let's talk about some of the issues I had. And I've managed to bypass or fix or hack my way around quite a few of them, so I'll try to give you some ideas on how you could do that. But be aware that this is not all the issues I've encountered. So first off, asset replacement. For my game, I spent a lot of time finding a font that I liked that had a lot of characters in them, because I was planning to use borders and table stuff, and not all fonts have this kind of stuff built into them. And I decided to go with Deja Vu Sans Mono because it had pretty much everything I wanted. Except, I discover it doesn't have all the Japanese or Arabic or Chinese characters in it. Which means that when I tried to do my Japanese translation, it just showed up as question marks. Which means that for these characters, I needed to find a new font. But I didn't want to use a font that had all the characters for every language in the world. I don't think that even exists. And I liked my Deja Vu Sans, so, you know, I wanted to keep it for the English. So I could, of course, have a different font and then use a script in JavaScript that will, like, dynamically change the font for all my labels and stuff, but I'd rather die than have to do so much work just for font replacement. Hopefully, Godot has a method for doing that, and it's very awesome. So once again, you go into the project setting, you go into the localization, and notice that there's a tab called asset replacement. And for this, what you need to do is you select any asset in your game. For example, in my case, I selected the font, and then you can add replacement. So you can say, for this asset in Japanese, use this other asset. And then automatically for the whole game, it's gonna use this asset when you're in this different language. This is especially useful if you have, for example, text in your texture. So if, for example, if you have like the sign in front of a store in your game or something, and you want to change the name of the store to something localized, then you can just have this in a texture, and then in this asset replacement, you can replace the texture. You can do that for any assets in your game, and this is very awesome. At that point, the translation was going pretty well. I had my asset replaced, I had my strings ID and all of this. And then I ran into my help dialog. That's just one big wall of rich text label formatted string. And I wasn't quite sure how to tackle that, because putting all of this text, like basically 20-30 line of text, in a CSV file with backslash n and trying to keep it looking good in the game sounded like a near impossible task. So I toyed with a couple of different ideas, and the thing I decided to end up doing is that I actually put the translation in the game. I just duplicated my rich text label, and I named the rich text label the same way the headers are named in the CSV file. And then I made a simple script on Ready. It fetches the local string in the translation server, and then it goes through all of these rich text label and it hides all of them and just shows the one that matched the string. And of course, I have a fallback to English if for some reason you're playing the game in a language that's not supported. So that does mean that if I decide to have someone professional translate my game, instead of just sending him the CSV file, I'm gonna have to send him like some special file with the formatted look of the window and dialogue, and I'm gonna have to put it in myself in the game. But that's a problem I'm willing to take for now, and we'll see how it goes when I actually decide to do that. The final issue that Godot handles pretty well is building string dynamically and then translating them. So for example, in my game, I have stuff like when you get hit, you will see a log that will say the enemy scout takes 10 damage. And of course, here scout and 10 are fetched dynamically, and then the whole string is concatenated to create the sentence. GDScript, like any good programming language, of course supports format string, and this is how you usually would do the translation. So I went back, took all the strings that I was concatenating with plus, and I made them one string, and I put format specifier in them. Now Godot has kind of two ways of doing that. You can do it with the format method, and you can pass it a dictionary, which will allow you to name the parameters inside your format string, which is really great if you have some language that sometimes flip the words around. So for example, in English it can be the scout takes 10 damage, but in Japanese you might want to write 10 damage was taken by the scout, for example. If the parameters are named in your translation, then you can just flip them around and use the format method, and you don't need to change your code, and it's going to work for all languages. Then, of course, there's also issues with numbers. For example, in French-speaking countries, usually we separate decimal with comma, but in English-speaking countries, as far as I know, you separate decimal with period. So if you wanted to do that, of course, Godot has this really nifty percent operator that you can use format specifier on them. The only issue I see with this is that you can't use both method. You either use named parameter in a dictionary, or you use format specifier with the percent operator. So if you want to use both, I think you're kind of fucked, but I haven't had this issue yet to have to use both of them at the same time, so, you know, hoping that it's not going to be an issue in the future. These are the things that I managed to do with just the built-in tools that Godot provides, and I have to admit, it's pretty good, even though there was some weird error message sometimes. I really liked how it was implemented. But believe me when I say this is not the sum of all the issues I've encountered during translation. This is just scratching the surface. But I wanted to keep this video not too long, so I'm going to do another video going more in depth about all the issues that you're going to encounter. And this is not just for Godot. This is going to be for localization in general, what it means, and how bad it can get when you want to translate in a lot of different languages. So until next week, see you guys in my next episode. Bye!